But are even at times mandated. So this is not just a question of privacy versus security. This is a question of security versus security. Breaking basic encryption, undermining data security, makes all of us more vulnerable to identity thieves, to cyber attacks, and anyone else who wishes to do us harm as well. With a backdoor that's as valuable as this one, that could unlock the phones of literally tens of millions of people. It's not a question of if it will be used by some nefarious actors at some point. It's really much more of a question of when and how much damage it will do when it finally is. Security experts by and large agree that weakening or circumvention of any sort of the security that keeps our phones safe actually puts everyone in danger. The very thing that protects some of our most valuable resources. And if Apple has to build a backdoor into their devices, the question is what device is next, and if the backdoor exists, what actually stops any malicious hackers or anybody else from being able to get access to it and being able to eventually use it. So I just want people to keep in mind that as much as privacy matters, the question that's being posed here is not the same one that's the same privacy versus security conversation. We're looking at two competing claims to security, and with how serious the ramifications are of undermining encryption and security protocols, the United States government is being just frankly irresponsible for asking for this. With a backdoor that affects so much information on so many different devices, it's not a question of if the backdoor will wind up being used by the, will wind up in the wrong hands. It's a question of when it will be. Thank you.
Thanks, Charlie. Thank you all for being here today and raising your voice in defense of privacy and security. Charlie described how what we're talking about here today and the values at stake in the ordered erosion of the Apple Core security protocols is not privacy versus security, but rather security versus security. I would describe it as privacy and security and international human rights against a government power grab. An opportunistic government power grab. And we have seen this before. Intelligence agencies have a habit of construing their powers as synonymous with national security. But we know that national security includes device security. It includes security of the ways that we track our own information, the ways that we communicate with our friends and neighbors and lovers, our political allies. And don't forget that these issues, the privacy and security and international human rights that stand on one side, are in fact For some people in the world, matters quite literally of life and death. If you are a dissident in a country ruled by an authoritarian regime, the power to gain access to all of your information by having the physical possession of the phone is exactly what every authoritarian government around the world would want. And I've heard people suggest the FBI's demands of Apple are not that bad because Russia and China could ask those things of Apple today. Except here's the kicker, right? Apple's always said no. Why would the government of the country that claims to lead the free world pave the road to an insecure future for all of us? And I'll just repeat what we're ultimately talking about here. Your privacy and your security, the security of the internet and the device platform and the international human rights that security and privacy protect against the interests of a government agency that misleads members of Congress, has misled courts, and is actively today, as we speak, misleading the public. These issues will continue to be in the forefront of the public discussion because they are actually being addressed by all three branches of the federal government at the moment. The judiciary is addressing these issues that you're seeing in Southern California. Apple will soon file a brief responding to the government's order there. My colleagues at the Electronic Frontier Foundation will soon be filing an amicus brief supporting Apple's position defending your rights in the face of the FBI's demands. In the executive branch, the Obama administration has long committed to responding in public to any petition securing the support of over 100,000 people last fall with the support of several organizations and over 100,000 supporters. We did petition the White House seeking stronger protections for encryption, not government demands attempting to erode it at the device security layer. The White House has yet to respond, as it has, again, promised to do. Finally, Congress will inevitably be taking up these issues later this year and others surrounding the intelligence agency's powers. And we hope very much that should the courts get this issue wrong and should the White House continue to ignore its commitments to respond to the public interest in stronger device encryption and communications encryption, we hope that you and your neighbors and your friends and your family can ensure that members of Congress are better informed when they grapple with these questions later this year. I do want to just take a moment and note that we are in a rare position of being able to praise a good actor here. That is not always the case in our line of work, and I'm very excited to see one of the world's largest corporations do the right thing by its customers, do the right thing by you. I'm sure they are very happy to see you here. I'll just address, I see a sign about a back door, if you guys will permit me the indulgence. There's a lot of debate about whether or not this order reaches a single phone, whether or not we're talking a back door, what is actually at stake here. The manufacturer of this device has made quite clear that the only way to comply with the judge's order in this case is to erode the security of the entire platform. Backdoors are used in security parlance to describe situations where you give someone access, and some have described that the judge's order doesn't create a backdoor because the FBI would still have to hack the phone even after Apple erodes its security protocols as the magistrate judge in Southern California has attempted to require it to do. It is a backdoor to the extent that the order requires the removal of a security gate, which would allow then the Bureau to brute force the phone. It is a functional backdoor being demanded by a government agency, which has misled the courts, which has misled Congress, which is actively working to mislead the public. We are talking about privacy, security, rights for everyone around the world in the face of a very intentional power grab by a government agency with a long litany of civil rights and human rights abuses under its belt. The last thing I'll just say is we only know with respect to what the intelligence agencies are doing and are capable of a fraction of the truth, because no one in Congress has ever bothered to ask the hard questions. And on the rare occasion that there have been tough questions posed to executive officials, we have heard lies in response. Until Congress actually investigates the full scope of our government surveillance and intelligence collection methods and operations, we cannot have any idea what we're ultimately dealing with here. The danger is much more than you will hear from the government. The danger is profound. I'm so glad to see you all out here today to raise your voices for privacy and security. And I would just invite you to give yourselves a round of applause. Please meet somebody new today. Don't let this be the last time you see them. And we have another speaker here to address you today. I'm very excited. Malkia, can you come up to the mic? Can you guys hear us down here on the side of the building? Raise your hand if you can.
So I like the first slide. Okay, I'll work on that.
I'm very, very excited.
Hey, how y'all doing? Can you hear me? I can't hear you. Can you hear me?
Right on.
Alright, so I'm here because there is no population in this country that needs encryption more than black people. Let me say that one more time. There is no population in this country that needs encryption more than black people. 50 years ago, they, Edgar Hoover, targeted black activism very explicitly, very specifically, and he made it very clear that to be a black activist in this country was dangerous. It was to dissent. And dissent is what we're talking about here today. This is not really so much about just the crossing of a civil liberty. I'm not here because I care desperately and deeply about privacy. I'm here because I care about my right to assemble, my right to speak freely. I'm here because I care about making sure that the devices that we use to navigate our daily lives in and out every single day are safe for our activism and for our organizing. I'm here because we know for a fact that right now Black Lives Matter activists are being surveilled. We know that for a fact. We have evidence and proof. Journalists have uncovered that. And so we need our devices to be safe. We need our devices to be secure. More importantly, it's not just about activism. What about everyday people? What about the fact that we use our phones, that we use our computers to navigate immigration, to navigate education, to navigate jobs? We need those devices to be safe. Because in this day, 21st century, oh, I heard that. I don't know what he's talking about. But what I'm talking about is in the 21st century, it is critical, right, in an era of digital, of data, big data, in a digital age, that encryption is not simply something for those with money. It isn't simply something for those with technological expertise. It's something that every single person on the planet should have access to. If hackers, and I love hackers, I ain't gonna even lie, but if hackers can get into the, you know, my bank account, I wanna know that my bank has a mandate to keep my money safe. If hackers can get into my personal information, I need to know that the companies that I paid my money to have a mandate to keep my information safe. And I should be able to rely on the government, on the FBI, and on Congress, really, to maintain that safety. Unfortunately, what we're seeing here is a power grab. What we're seeing here is a power grab. The FBI is reaching for power. They are using this moment to expand the police state. And I want to hear you say, hell no.
Hell no.
Hell no.
Hell no.
Hell no.
Hell no.
Because we will not stand for that. We will not allow for our rights to be withered away. We will not be intimidated by the FBI. And they say that this is about terrorism. But we know that this is not about terrorism. We understand that, in fact, much of the information that they could get from the phone that they're trying to get, they've already gotten. We know that. So what this is really about is about repressing the right to dissent. It's about repressing our capacity to organize, and that is what we are saying no to. We're not saying no to national security. In fact, we're saying yes to national security. We're saying that privacy and encryption makes us safer. It makes us safer, not less safe, more safe. I want to hear you say yes.
Yes.
Say yes.
Yes.
That's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about keeping us safe through encryption. I'm talking about keeping us safe through protecting our Fourth Amendment rights, and talking about keeping us safe through organizing, and that's what I have to say. Black Lives Matter, baby!
Yeah!
Give yourselves a round of applause one more time for being here. Please meet somebody new, trade information with somebody you can connect with. We will need to do this likely again and again and again. They will not stop.
We won't either. We'll see you here again soon.
Thanks for coming out, everybody.
You're right.